When my son Spencer was 10 years old, he wanted to burn his math textbook. And I actually let him. So let me give you the backstory. In fourth grade, my son had one of those cheaply printed disposable textbooks, the kind where students did all their work in the book so it couldn't be used again. When it came home for the last time at the end of the year, he wanted to burn it. I said sure, and I went out in the backyard with Spencer and his older brother Joseph, who was 12 years old or so. We had a number 10 can, and the kids tore off a page, crumpled it, put it in the can, did the same thing for a couple more pages, then lit them on fire. In my devious mind, I thought of a way to get one more math lesson out of that math book, and it might be in the running for the most ironic math problem ever. Please take a second to subscribe to our channel for more interesting uses of mathematics in the real world. If you enjoy this video, please like it and share it. That really helps our channel. Okay, back to my pyromaniac kids. Spencer and Joseph started burning the book one page at a time since the can was so small. They would rip out a page, crumple it, and then put it into the can when the previous pages were nearly done burning. It was taking a while. After a bunch of pages, I casually remarked, "This isn't going very fast. How long do you think we're going to be out here burning this thing?" My kids actually did math to find out how long it would take to burn their hated math textbook. 12-year-old Joseph soon devised a plan so that they could actually calculate the approximate amount of time it would take to burn the book. First, they timed how long it would take to burn 10 pages. It was about 3.5 minutes. Then they checked what page they were currently on, let's say they're on page 47, and looked at the last page number in the book, let's say 454, and subtracted the two to get 407 pages. But Joseph soon realized that number is actually about twice the number of pages because there are two page numbers in each page, so next they divide by 2 to get 203.5 pages. But that's not a whole number, so they round it up since they have to burn the back cover as well. Now they divide the number by 10, because they know how long it takes to burn 10 pages. So the resulting quotient, 20.4, is how many groups of 10 they could organize the remaining pages into. Each one of these groups of 10 will take 3.5 minutes to burn, so they multiply those two together, and rounding 20.4 down to 20, we get 70 minutes to burn his math book. They realized that's much longer than they wanted to take to burn the book, so we created a safe place for a bigger fire. They ravishly tore up the book and made one large pile. Then we burned it in our own little end of the school year celebration mini bonfire. In the end, I thought maybe our kids would be better at math if they had to burn a math book every day. In the end, I was quite impressed with the reasoning my sons were able to do, even if it was the sixth grader leading the way. He sure was a good model. Think about how different this process was from a typical math problem in school. The problem was, how long is it going to take to burn the math book? Compare that to a typical US school math problem like this one. What's the difference between these two problems? Well, first, there are only two numbers written as numerals, so as a student, you just need to figure out which operation to use, and since this is on a worksheet titled Multiplying Decimal Word Problems, well, that's pretty obvious. Second, to solve, you're expected to do the pencil and paper algorithm that your teacher has been teaching you for the last week. Third, you don't even have to do the calculation to get the problem correct. With a little thinking, you realize that A is too small, D is too big, so it has to be B or C, and since three of the answers start with 65, the answer is probably B, so you pick B. Fourth, your teacher gets mad at you for not showing your work. Now my son's problem has no numbers. They have to devise a plan on how to generate or find the numbers they need and what operations to do. It required generating their own data for the problem through an empirical experiment. There are multiple steps that use mathematics from all across the elementary school curriculum. They're also free to use whatever methods they can to help them solve the problem. It's reasonable in this problem to estimate or round. And the hard part of the problem was not the calculations, it was devising a plan to solve the problem. Finally, no one gets mad at you for not showing your work. The difference between the skills needed for the school math problem and my son's problem is huge. Researchers in the US would call the work my sons did as quantitative reasoning, and in the UK, numeracy. These usually refer to the everyday situations that require sense-making with math, statistics, and probability. Research shows that most students struggle with basic quantitative reasoning skills, at least here in the United States. Why is that? Oftentimes, students can do the calculations correctly when presented, like a school math problem, but they can't put it all together when simply asked a question like, "How long will it take to burn this math book?" I don't have all the answers here, and I bet many of you have some good insights. What do you think? Put your thoughts in the comments about why strong quantitative reasoning skills are so elusive for a large part of the population in so many countries. I believe one reason is that students get very little practice with problems like my son's problems in school, and it's hard to develop skills you don't practice. Well, you'll be happy to know that Spencer enjoys math. He is interested in many science topics that he studies on his own. He once asked me to help him with a paper he was reading that explained the math behind how planes fly. And just this week he was watching a video on understanding the science of electricity, and I got to explain a vector cross product to him, because the video was using it and he hadn't learned it yet. Spencer also still enjoys fire, and is known to improvise fire dances to the fire gods at campouts. Do you know of any ironic math problems? Put those in the comments as well. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe and share our videos. Be sure to follow Math the World on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Thank you so much for your support.